Good evening, and we certainly thank you all for coming tonight. This is a view from the top of Stockpole, which Mike will talk a little bit later in the talk. And this was 2 weeks in northern Scotland. And quite frankly, this talk and this whole field trip would not have happened without Mike and Virginia Adler having made several trips over there and actually have found the guide that we used for the time we were in Scotland. So the outline of the talk, I'm going to start off a little bit with the formation of Scotland, how the rocks got there, and that gets us pretty quickly into plate tectonics. We'll talk a little bit about the Highlands controversy, and then we'll get into the geology of the North West Highlands of Scotland, and I'll hand it off to Mike, and then he will go on a little bit more in the Highlands and then take you down to the Isle of Skye. So let's start off with a map of Great Britain. If you look at this map carefully, you'll see some things. This is England down here, Ireland over here, and Scotland up to the north. If you look at the various colors and up here at the chart, you'll see that England is mostly made up of much younger rocks. And as you come north, right here, there's a pretty dramatic change from the blues into these purples, which are much older rocks. And it's almost like a line that goes across. And this just happens to be where Hadrian's Wall is. Here's Edinburgh. There's another change just north of Edinburgh that's a very sharp, essentially, line across Scotland. Another one up a little further north. But this is the very furthest north of the Scotland, and this is where we were, the Scottish Highlands and down to the Isle of Skye. Now, if you look at this a little differently, here is just a physiographic map. Here is that one cut I talked about that kind of goes right underneath Hadrian's Wall, England down here, Scotland up here. Here is Edinburgh and Glasgow. And again, another quite dramatic change if you go from here kind of across. You get all the way up here to where we flew into at Inverness, and this is Loch Ness, and again, this is a very dramatic cut across Scotland and all the way to the farthest north. Now, here is just the geology of Scotland, and again, you can see these demarcations that I have been pointing out, the changes, the dramatic changes down at Hadrian's Wall, coming across just north of Glasgow and Edinburgh. And then here is Inverness and essentially Loch Ness that cuts right straight across. And you can see the various changes in the rocks that we basically start off with some Ordovician rocks. We move further north. We get into some Precambrian, and then in these pinks out here, some of the oldest rocks on Earth, that we'll be talking about, Lewisian gneiss, 3 billion years old. As contrasted with the Isle of Skye, which is over here, which you'll notice is all very young igneous material. And we'll talk about why that is juxtapositioned in between very old Lewisian gneiss. Well, to understand Scotland and how it was formed, we've got to go back 600 million years when there was a supercontinent kind of centered at the South Pole, Gondwanaland, as it's named. And if you look, you will see Laurentia. This is essentially the North American continent. You can see that's Hudson's Bay, the Great Lakes. Here's Greenland. Over here is what's called Baltica. And if you look carefully, that's actually Norway, kind of sitting up here. And here's what will become Scotland. And you'll notice even all the way back here, you will see that it's shown as having been cut in three different little segments that, as we go through time, will make up eventually Scotland. Now let's jump forward 100 million years to 500 million years. And this is when Gondwanaland begins to break apart. Laurentia starts moving north. It's getting up closer to the equator. And the thing that you should notice is that, in fact, Scotland is actually attached to this continental mass, Laurentia. And here's Greenland, Hudson's Bay. And Scotland is basically tagging along with the North American plate. Here's Baltica, and here you can much clearer see Norway. It's kind of the wrong orientation, but with a little drifting it'll get in the right orientation. And right down here, kind of following behind, is Avalonia, which eventually will make up England. It's kind of the last to drift north from Gondwanaland. Then we come up to 400 million years ago, here's 400 million years ago, and what you can see here is North America, here's the equator, so we're essentially drifted fairly far north. Here's Hudson's Bay, here's the Great Lakes, here's Greenland, here is Baltica over here, and Baltica and Laurentia have actually crashed together, and then in the middle of the collision is Scotland, and you can see those three very distinct faults that go through Scotland. And you'll notice that they actually go all the way down through the eastern part of North America. And in fact, this is when the Appalachian Mountains were formed. This over here is Avalonia, England, kind of still not quite docked in with Scotland. Now if we look at this collision a little bit more carefully, here's Greenland, here's our pieces of Scotland, and here's Baltica, basically in a fairly intense collision coming together. And you can see that the material from which is crust, granitic material in Norway, is actually going down and underneath Scotland, and a great deal of compression right through here, and you'll see these lines that indicates from some faulting, and the MTB is actually the Moyne thrust belt. We'll talk a little bit more about that as we go through and in detail. So strong collision between Laurentia, and here's Greenland, and Baltica coming together, Avalonia kind of docking gently from the south. Now to take a look at what this rock actually looks at, this is the 3 billion year old Lewisian gneiss. You look at this and I see what I call very tired rock. You can kind of see that it's has a lot of fracturing in it, and it's been completely exposed by glaciation. What's interesting is that here is the Lewisian gneiss in Scotland, on one of the islands, just off of Scotland. Here is the gneiss in Newfoundland, with Virginia Adler standing here for scale. And you can see that this is exactly the same rock, exactly the same terrain, so that we can actually have clear proof that Scotland and North America were once together. The other big player and in northern Scotland is the Torridonian sandstone. And this is just a massive pile of very coarse-grained sandstones. Here's a farmhouse for scale down over here. And what this tells, and this is 1 billion years ago. So we jumped from 3 billion-year-old Lewisian gneiss to 1 billion-year-old Torridonian sandstone. And you can see here that this is when there has been yet another set of mountains earlier, 1 billion years ago, that were built and are like the Himalayas are today and being rapidly eroded. That's where all this Torridonian sandstone is coming from, being peeled off the top of these high, probably 20,000 plus foot mountains that formed 1 billion plus years ago when another continental collision occurred. So now let's take a look in a little bit more detail just in the northern highlands. This is Ullapool. We stayed there for a while, but the pink in here is the Lewisian gneiss, and you can see it all the way up and down the west coast of Scotland in the Highlands. You can also see that it's been cut by a number of dikes. These are different dikes. We'll show you some examples of those. The bright red is the Torridonian sandstone, so 3 billion-year-old gneiss, 1 billion-year-old Torridonian sandstone. And then the blues, the light and dark blue, is the Cambrian, limestone and quartzite. And then all the yellow here is the Moyne Thrust, which we'll talk a little bit more about, and is actually sitting up over the top of a lot of this material. Now, to really understand and why do you go to the Northwest Highlands and why this area was such so important in the founding of the laws of geology, you've got to go back and really appreciate kind of in the late 1600s what were the definitions of the ages of rocks, and they were just literally primary, secondary, and tertiary. And in fact, there was debate going on whether or not the Earth was formed in 6 days or 6,000 years, or was it much older than that? Later on, in the late 1700s, things began to get sorted out. The primary and secondary began to get broken into a lot of the terms we know today in the Silurian, Ordovician, Cambrian, and Precambrian. And then early in the 1800s, a theory developed called the Law of Uniformitarianism. And basically what that means is, or says, is that older rocks are always underneath younger rocks. So if you have two rocks together and they're stacked on top of each other, whichever one is on top is by definition then the younger rock. That was the theory. That was what the British Geological Survey used in all their mapping of this area, and kind of developed the maps with this idea in mind. The third point is that thrust faulting, and we'll talk about what exactly a thrust fault is, had not really been recognized. So why do you go to northern Scotland? Well, you've got 3 billion years of rocks. There's virtually no ground cover, and so everything is visible, and this is really where the modern understanding of geology and the rules that we use today and how we do the mapping were developed. Now, so it's really the birthplace of modern geology. As I was saying, back in the late 1700s, James Hutton was the one that really first started talking about that the present is the keys to the past, and he was the one that talked about that the Earth was vastly older in time than what had been previously thought, that we were into millions of years, not thousands of years. In 1830, Charles Lyell put out a book, Principle of Uniformitarium, in his book, The Theory of Geology. And this was this concept that if there's two rocks stacked on top of each other, the one on top must be younger. And Charles Darwin actually used this whole theory of that was in this book in much of his studies as he was traveling on the Beagle. There was also gentleman Lapworth in the 1880s that came to the highlands, and he was the one that really began to understand the thrusting and folding that had taken place up there. Now, there was this highlands controversy. So the British Geological Survey, and you have to understand back in this time period, there was the professional geologists. Those were those that were employed by the British Geological Survey, traveled all over the earth mapping things. But they had come up and mapped the Northern Highlands, and they had done it along the rules of Charles Lyell and the uniformitarianism. And then there were the amateur geologists. And these were the professors that were actually teaching in the universities. They were considered second-class geologists, but the geologists, the professors at like Aberdeen and Edinburgh universities had traveled up to the Northern Highlands, and in about 1840 they began to say, wait a minute, there's this concept of the rocks on top are always younger are not correct. And this became known as the Highlands Controversy. And it took from 1840 to the early 1880s, and it took a change in management at the British Geological Survey before they actually sent two people, Ben Peach and John Horn, up to the Highlands to figure out who was right and what was this, and see if they could resolve this Highland controversy. Now let's talk about the rocks that we're going to be dealing with in a little bit more detail. This is what they did. They went up and really looked closely at the rocks. You had the Lewisian gneiss. This is this very old Precambrian with no fossils, high-grade metamorphic rock, 3 billion years old, and this is a close-up example of some Lewisian gneiss. Then you had the next major rock group was this Torridonian sandstone, which is 1 billion years old. So you literally had a 2 billion year gap between here and here. And you can see that the rocks here, this is this very coarse grain sandstone containing conglomerates of other rocks. And it has not really been metamorphosed. Then we go to the Moyne schist. It is a Precambrian medium grade, a little younger still, metamorphic rock. And it's made up of some somewhat unusual rocks, a very laminar, micas, chlorites, talc, graphite, these kinds of things that are very flat or laminar. And you can literally see that in these pictures where you've got very thin laminar beds that, and you can see it up here as well. And this is the material that gets caught up in the moin thrust. And we'll talk about that in just a second. Then we go to the Cambrian rocks, the Durness limestone, which is named after the very further north town of Durness. We have some Saltarella grits in here. We have some fucoid beds. This Cambrian, you're beginning to see some life, these little blobs, light-colored blobs in here. And finally, the Cambrian quartzite here with actually worm tubes. It's called pipe rock, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. So you know there's life at this age in this Cambrian quartzite, which was a very pure quartzite, sandstone made up of quartz and feldspar. And then the last player is the moin thrust, and that is all this brown area, and the actual front of the thrust is shown by this black line that has these little triangles. That's the symbol for a thrust fault that comes all the way from the furthest northern point of the highlands to the south. It is younger, it's Caledonian orogeny, Ordovician to early Silurian in age, 455 to 430 million years ago. It literally was lifted up and thrusted over the older rocks, the Cambrian and Precambrian rocks that were out here. It moved some 50 miles from east to west over a period of several million years. Has a very low angle of the dip of the fault. At the base of the fault is between 10 and 20 degrees. And you can see it for more than 120 miles from north to south. So now to finish up on plate tectonics, things didn't stay put after the collision back 400 million years ago. About 80 million years ago, North America and Europe and South America and Africa actually parted company and began to move apart. They split apart and began to move. This is where they were about 40 million years ago. And you can see that Greenland a little later split off from Baltica, and here is Scotland sitting right out in the middle of it. Now, how do we know all this worked? You can see the Mid-Atlantic Ridge shown on this right down the center, and that was the key to really the acceptance of plate tectonics. Here is a bathymetric map of the North Atlantic. You can see the continents. Here's Scotland right up in here, Iceland, Greenland, and you can see the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, and it's cut with transform faults, and literally you can trace that, you know, this material here in Newfoundland was at one time right up next to Spain, and it shows you that Greenland literally came over and was docked in here with Scotland. The real clinching point is shown on this map. Here again is Scotland over here, Greenland and Iceland, and the Mid-Atlantic Ridge right down here. Now what's shown on here with these lines is the magnetic signature of the ocean floor. We all know that the magnetic poles reverse every 400,000 to 700,000 to maybe even more than a million years. The magnetic north and south flip, basically. And when they started in the 60s doing very detailed magnetic imaging of the seafloor and sampling of the seafloor, they noticed that here was the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, and on this side and this side were rocks that were of the same magnetic orientation and of the exact same age. Then they went out to this next band on either side, and they were the same age, but of the flipped orientation. And then they would go out to the next band, and it's back flipped reverse, and here it is over on the other side. And so this was the absolute smoking gun. This was what showed us that literally new crust was being formed at the Mid-Atlantic Ridge and moving away from it. And you could see that it was progressively older as you moved away. And it was a mirror image on either side of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And this is when plate tectonics was completely accepted and people realized how the plates moved through time. Well, here's our guides, Donald and Wendy Fisher. Donald is the expert, expert in Highland geology and for many years led field trips and was in the parks and areas in here. This is Wendy. She was also with us and led some of the women and other folks that got tired of looking at geology on some other excursions. They're standing in front of the monument that was put up to Peach and Horn for the mapping that they did 14 years from 1883 to 1897. They spent mapping up in this area. Well, now let's take a look at how the geologists got together on the first night. Here we are at our social get-together. Here's Donald, Elizabeth, Mary. This is Betty Elliott. So we're all sitting around getting to know each other a little bit better. And, you know, typical to geologists of Jackson Hole, we had to kind of rough it a little bit out in the field, and this was our first evening meal together. And we even had our own bus with a little name in the window, so we felt like we were really official in the Northern Highlands. We're going to use this map to kind of show where we are going and what we're going to see. We started off down here at the south at Inverness. We spent the first night just a little north of Inverness, and then we've traveled up, and the first place we're going to show is Loch Glencoole, which is right here, and we'll talk about that. That's where Peach and Horn first came and looked at the rocks. Then we're going to go on up to the very northern point to Smooth Cave, and then on over to Ben Arnable, where the thrust fault was first recognized. Before we get there, we're going to go by this Gaelically named beach, which I'm not even going to try to pronounce, where you will begin to see the tectonic deformation that's just incredible that has occurred up in this Northwest Highlands. Then we're going to come back down to this little town of Scory and look at some of those dikes that we showed that are in the Louisian gneiss. And then we're going to come a little further south and we're going to look at some Cambrian pipe rock. And then I'm going to hand it over to Mike to continue on further south and show you these other areas to the south and on over to the Isle of Skye. So here we are at the Glencoole, or Loch Glencoole, and this is where Peach and Horn, on their very first year, came and mapped. And in fact, this at the bottom is a copy of their map of what you're looking at right here. And what they saw is they saw Louisian gneiss over here, Louisian gneiss over here, and in the middle of it, they saw Cambrian quartzite. So this material right here is Cambrian quartzite, whereas this is Louisian gneiss. This is Louisian gneiss. They also have some more details up in here where you've got folded rocks, a little harder to see here. And you get all the way over to just a pit of the Moyne thrust up on top. Got to go the right way here, sorry. So here is our same picture, and now we've interpreted 3 billion year old gneiss in the middle of a 550 million year old sandwich of quartzite. Quartzite is up on top here, and then 880 million year old Moin schist is up on top of the whole thing, up on top over here. Here we were on the first day at literally the monument that the Scottish government has put out explaining all the geology here, and here's Donald, very expressive, always has his hands to show us and explain what's going on here. And our crew really getting into the geology and beginning to get into the understanding. Here we are at the, several of us at the monument for to Peach and Horn that we saw Wendy and Donald at earlier. And as I mentioned, this, it was put here in 1930, but they actually studied from 1883 to 1897. But the interesting piece is at the end of the very first year, when they finished their work at Lake Lochlin Coal, they sent a note back to London to the British Geological Survey with a kind of a short little message. The amateurs are correct. And that was what they very quickly realized. We were actually able to go. The hotel where Peach and Horn stayed is still there. Here are their signatures. Ben Peach and John Horn when they checked into the hotel. And it was quite a bit of history that we're looking at here. So now we go all the way, and we're actually looking north, the far northern edge of Scotland. And this is a classic normal fault. So here is some Cambrian material, and this is the surface of the fault plain. You can see it's what we call dipping to the west. And if you look at this slope right here, you can see that it looks like the material that used to be up here has just slipped down into this bay. And so when the angle of the fault is in this orientation, they're called normal faults. If this fault face was in the opposite direction, basically coming up in an opposite orientation, we would call that a reverse fault. And then lastly, if this angle was very low, here you can see we're at about probably 80 degrees, 75 degrees dip angle on the fault face. If we had the fault at 10 degrees or 15 degrees, so it would be very low, almost this angle up on top, then you would call it a thrust fault. And that was something else that was first discovered here in Scotland. They also pioneered the understanding over in Switzerland. So here we are at Smooth Cave. We're walking back into the some of the Cambrian limestones in here, and you quickly find out why the cave was formed. The area was Cambrian rocks were weakened by the faulting in the area, and the river came down, and it's actually this falls inside the cave. And if you turn around and look out, you can see the Cambrian limestone bedded and going on out. Just a beautiful place to come and look at the geology. Now, one of the reasons that you come to Northern Scotland to look at geology is there is virtually no real cover. certainly in the mountains you can see exactly what's going on, and the only real cover is this peat here on the ground. And they actually dig the peat up, dry it out, and burn it to heat their homes in northern Scotland. And that's what they've been doing here, is actually cutting the peat. Here's our intrepid travelers. I think this was our second day out. You can see that we've all got our gear on, and you wonder, well, what's going on? Look at the grass in the background. You'll see that we're standing more or less straight, except for a bud here, but we're in about a 30 to 40 knot wind. So, but we're walking up across the beach, going up behind where we are right now, to take a look at some of the wildlife. So here we have a little puffin. There was a whole colony of them, and so here's a puffin coming in for a landing. There was also some cormorants up here that we were able to see. So, you know, yeah, we're looking at rocks, but we're not opposed to looking at wildlife. And of course, then you get Jennifer Truman, and this is Doug and Nancy Ayers. They're actually bringing the cows home here. They decided to follow them across the beach as we're headed back to the bus. Now, this is this Gaelic named beach, and you can begin to see some pretty interesting geology here. If you start over here on the left, this is Lewisian gneiss. So this is 3 billion years old rock. Then you come over here to this black rock on the right. This is 2.3 billion year old. So 3 billion, this is now 2.3 billion year old, and this is a one of the very dark igneous material that's kind of injected in here. And then lastly, this light colored is 1.7 billion year old, and this is a pegmatite. This is quartz rich, feldspar rich, again, that is kind of injected in here. And you can just begin to see the juxtaposition of rocks, and you begin to understand the tectonic forces that basically shoved, and over numerous periods of time, Scotland around and placed these rocks in amongst each other. We're actually coming over here to look at what's called boudinage. That's a good French term for sausage. And this is Donald up here for scale, but you can literally see the sausage where the pegmatite has pulled apart literally the 2.3 billion year old rock. Here it's just the other way around. We've got the pegmatite in these kind of blobs in Lewisian gneiss. So just incredible tectonic deformation here that absolutely shows that plate tectonics has been going on for at least the last 2.5 billion years. Now we're going to move over to Ben Arnable, and we've hiked up to the thrust fault. This is where you can see it right here. You've got Cambrian quartzite, this light yellow material underneath. You've got Moyne thrust material up on top. And so this material on top has been thrust this direction from basically left to right, up and over the top of the Cambrian. And this is where geologists really first understood and appreciated the thrusting that was going on in this area. Here we are all up right in front of the, right below the plane of the thrust fault. It's right here. And you can actually see Cambrian quartzite is very, very hard rock. But the forces involved here. You can see this fracturing that has gone on in the Cambrian quartzite right above our heads. Then there's this black layer. This is a myelinite zone. This is where the rocks, primarily from the block above in the Moyne Schist, has literally been stretched in very thin or laminar right in here, and then into the main thrust rock up on top. Here's Mike Shearer and Brent Schaefer, and Mike has got his hands right at the top of the quartzite, and here's this myelinite zone that you can see everything just kind of crushed and very laminar. Turn around the other way, and this is the view out from where we are. We came up from the road down below. Of course, you can see the spot on the lens here. It was raining pretty good, but it was just coming across this peat and hiking our way up to this place. Now, one of the days, some of us actually took a day off from geology and went over to the east coast on the North Sea of Scotland to visit the Duke of Sutherland's castle, Dunrobin. The Sutherlands have been in this area for 400 or 500 years. They're not particularly well liked because back in the 1800s, one of the dukes basically threw all the Scottish people off of his land, shipped them to Australia or the U.S. so that he could have better hunting and start farming or growing sheep. But not a bad place. He still lives here up on the upper floors, and the lower floors are open to the public. He also has a collection of raptors, and they put on shows, and this is an owl that literally went right over my head. You couldn't hear him at all, and managed to land on this one gentleman that wouldn't sit down. Luckily, he had a hat on. And then I was able, he also had a peregrine falcon, and here you can see a peregrine falcon in full flight. Here he is, probably doing 150 miles an hour as he's coming by trying to catch this lure that gentleman that was talking to us, our guide, was telling us about the birds. Just fascinating to watch. Of course, there was also some geology over here, a nice little geological museum, some great samples of malachite and other minerals in here. They also had this just incredible piece of Norwegian eclogite with these red garnets in it. Now, wouldn't you like that? This is a piece about 4 foot square. Wouldn't you like that as a countertop? Well, before you get too carried away with that thought, I do have to tell you that the Norwegians have realized that this is very rare and very valuable rock, so if you try to take a piece of this, even in your pocket, out of Norway, they will arrest you and put you in jail. So now we've come to the just south of the little town of Skåre, and you have Lewisian gneiss up over here on the hillside. So we got 3 billion year old gneiss here. Here's some more 3 billion year old gneiss that we're standing on, and you see this very black rock right in between. That is this igneous dike of basalt that's come up and injected in between and broken open the Lewisian gneiss. Here we have Mike actually standing on the contact. This hand is up on this grayish material is the Lewisian gneiss. The black material behind him and under his feet is actually the contact zone, and if you get up and look at it closely, you can see that when this dike was injected in here, there was some tectonic deformation right at the contact, all this kind of gnarly looking material. says it wasn't all that fluid, and there was it was forcibly injected in between in a zone of weakness in the gneiss. Lastly, talk about the Cambrian pipe rock. Now, this is a 550 million year old Cambrian. This is quartzite. It is basically almost pure quartz that has been through time cemented up to be a very, very hard rock. But when it was sand on a beach, there was worms, just like there are today, the little worms that bore in the sand called polychaete worms. And you can see where they have actually burrowed down into the sandstone when it was soft and a beach back in the Cambrian. So we now know that we have life in the 550 million years ago. Now, what's really interesting here is the very distinctive white worm tubes in an otherwise Cambrian quartzite that has been basically changed to a reddish color. And that says that there was a lot of debate about how this happened. You know, was this white material something that came along later and got filled and all this? The current thought process is that when the worms died in these tubes, in the little pipe, they actually changed their organic material decomposing, changed the composition of took out the oxygen, so that when this quartzite was later, the iron was basically rusted in here to this red color. The chemistry in the worm or the wormholes was such that that could not be changed to the reddish color, that the organic material in there had changed the oxygen levels such that it couldn't change that. Now at that, I also have to show you that there was a little wildlife. Here's some deer, a little scrawny looking deer, but a bunch of deer up on top of the mountains, just having a good old time watching us, of course, wondering what we're doing. And now I'm going to turn it over to Mike, who's going to take over the talk and talk about the southern part of this map and start off at Knockin' Craig, which is right in here. So Mike, you want to go ahead and take over?
And this was the whole trip was pretty amazing, because you're going to see some really very interesting stuff here. Just point out where some of these things are. Knockin' Craig is going to be the first thing I'm going to talk about, and it's located here. I'm going to jump back up, because not everybody did this walk, and I happen to be one that did it. So this was, I'll talk about Strathdyanard. Then Stackpole was a climb of the mountain, actually was the first picture, the title picture. Clatchtoll, this whole beach area here, we spent quite a few days here looking at going to Clatchtoll, Point of Store, Ekmelvik, and the old Manastor, which is right on the very tip here. Then we're going to, we're getting towards the end of our stay in the Highlands. We'll go to the Bone Caves. And then there was some of us, not us, not me, but some of us went down to the Inview Gardens. You'll see some very pretty growth, flowers and such. And then on our way to Skye, we stop here at Mount Shylock, and it's also very interesting. So this is Knockin' Craig. These are Peach and Horn, actual pictures. They stayed, this was a picture taken of them outside the Inca Dam Hotel, where their residence essentially when they were here. And the story here at Knockin' Craig kind of tells you a lot about the history of these two gentlemen, as well as a lot about the geology here. This is part of the geopark, the of the Scotland geopark. And these are statues of Peach and Horn right at Knockin' Craig. And here's Donald explaining the wonders of Knockin' Craig to us. Again, it wasn't actually raining, but it was cold. and blustery. Typical of, unfortunately, of this part of our trip. So this is the cliffside of Knockin' Craig, and it's pretty amazing. Now there's a car that will give you some idea of the scale here. But I'm on this rock here, and this is quartzite. And then we transition to the pipe rock, the Foucoid belts that John told you about, the Saltarella grit right in this area, and then the white rock up here is Durness limestone, and here's the Moyne schist. So quite a, you see five layers of sedimentary rock. And this is why Knockin' Craig is so famous, because you can see it all right here. And what you do is a trail that you walk up among those. And so here's just some of the rock. There's the pipe rock you've already seen, and that transitions into this Foucoid, which is kind of a sandstone, siltone, vegetable manner mix with cemented together by carbonate. The Saltarella is a variation on that, and then you get into the limestone. And then here's the contact between the 500 million year old 550 and the 800 million year old Moyne schist. And you see the hands here. This is really oriented. A lot of this is for children, so they can put their hands. And some of us are, you'll see later, some of us are just older children. We do the same thing. But here's Virginia, you can see the path winding its way up here, and the Durness limestone and the schist above it. And so here's Christine actually doing this holding between these areas. So as I say, we're all children. We talked earlier, or John talked about the myelinized schist, and this is a real close-up of it, and it's just highly stressed rock because you have these two layers moving across each other, and it's just a lot of stress builds up in the rock and creates this kind of broken up linear structure. And here we are on the very top of Knockin' Craig Cliff. I showed you the whole thing. And in the background are a couple of mountains. This is Coldeeg, about 2,500 feet, and that's Stack Poli. You would never guess that's the way it's pronounced. You look at Poli, but anyway, the locals say Stack Poli, so who am I to disagree? And we end up climbing that. So I'm going to just go back up north, though, because this was Donald took us on this particular trek to show us imbricate structure. And it really wasn't until I got back that I understood this so well. And this diagram is a great help. So what you have here initially is essentially a flat layer of, in this case, it's all quartzite, but it could be made up of many layers, of different layers. And in fact, there are examples of that too. But this particular area, it's all quartzite. So, and there are little, maybe small faults, zones of weakness. And then when you have the plate moving from the left to right across it, it's literally lifting up one of these layers. It lifts one up and then it lifts another one, and so it lifts one, and so you can see if you look carefully, and in this diagram you can see the lines. So these are all the same layer, but it was originally laying flat, and the thrust lifted this stuff up one layer after another to build this mountain. And it continues, and that's why this diagram is just so spot on for this. It continues, and you'll actually get some real bending, and you can see it right here. Look at that. You can see that bending over as that thrust. This looks like different rock. I asked Donald about this just the other day. He says, "No, this is all the same. This is all quartzite." But anyway, this was. But the key was, this is supposed to be a 6 mile hike, and it turned out to be 11. So not everybody made it this far. So anyway, yeah. So here we're going to go down to the Ascent area, which is the kind of the cornerstone where we're at. Get my bearings here. There's Scurry, and the Ascent area is this area around here. And we are staying down in Ullapool, which is somewhere down here. And this is the Ascent area, and it's all the rock is old, some of it very old, like 3 billion years old. But the Ascent geography and geology are just tightly coupled. And so you have I'll go through this quickly. You have all of this 3 billion year old gneiss, and then you have the 1 billion year old sandstone. Then the quartzite are molten builders, because quartz is more resistant to erosion than the sandstone, and so many of the higher peaks have quartz on top. And then you have the Moyne to the east. So this is Stackpole, from the summit of Stackpole. And there's what you're looking at here, all of this stuff down at this level is the gneiss. And the upper part here is the sandstone. And this is a iconic mountain called Sibelin. This is Culmore. At one time, 800 million years ago, the mountains were at their highest, and this sandstone was up at 17,000 feet, and it's all eroded away, or most of it, down to where most of this area here is the harder gneiss that's survived. Yeah, so this is an area basically of gneiss, but with isolated mountains of sandstone. And this is a picture we took 2 years ago. We've been here. Virginia and I were here in 2012, and then we met Donald, and then in 2013 we went back to study the geology. I addressed the same group about that, and that kind of developed into the trip that we're just on. But anyway, we had slightly better weather in 2013. But anyway, here's some of our group up on the side of Stackpole. We have Betty and Jennifer and Brent and Bud and Bonnie and Virginia, and I'm taking. But this, as you go back here, this is stunning country, though. You have this incredible, these mountains and the colorful rock, but you have these inland lakes, and it's just, the whole scene is just amazing. And the ocean is just to my, just to the right off this picture, and I'll show you a view of that. Yeah, and so this is the cross-bedded sandstone. I'll do with some Johnson and point all them here, but these are all different layers of sandstone that were subjected to a lot of shearing, and so you get this these bedding lines across the sandstone. And okay, and here you're seeing the ocean. So these are these lakes, but there's the actual open ocean up there. It's just a really interesting mix of lake and mountain and ocean, which I find. I actually like, John was saying about the gneiss, how it is kind of older. I happen to love that kind of terrain. And that's, we've been to Newfoundland 18 times to walk in this stuff. So we happen to, so Scotland, we feel right at home here. But this is looking north along the coast. And I think that's probably the point of store that we'll be going to very shortly. We took a little side trip at the end of that climb. We went all the way to the coast. And here's Mary Springer, by the way, in her orange parka. And this is one of the denizens here. This is what's called a Hebridean goat. What a interesting character. Okay, so we're now going along the coast and just north of where that last picture was taken to a place called Clatchtoll, and this is a famous spot. This is an iconic feature. It's called Split Rock, and all of this is 1 billion year old sandstone. But this stuff here is a 3 billion year old gneiss, and the stripe, that is the line between the two, runs just about north south, and so you have these. The sandstone and the gneiss. What's interesting on this next picture, this is the sandstone, this is further along. The stripe, that is the line between them, is going out to sea. And it's because there once was an ancient canyon here, and it caused the rock would shape itself to the canyon, and you got the stripe to actually change its direction 90 degrees in this one area. So here's John. We had to have a few pictures of him. So in his talk, he had pictures of me. So I'm showing a nice picture of John here at Split Rock. And these are some of the flowers on the cliff. Very pretty. And the next is kind of one of the features here is stromatolites. This is the fossil of stromatolites. These go back a billion years. These are some of the oldest life forms, the original oldest life forms on the Earth. And these are the fossil remains of them. And you can see the coin there to get some concept of the size, but this is all in that 1 billion year old sandstone. This is another feature in the Clatskill area, and these are called lazy beds. The land here is not really easy to farm. Why? Little rocky. And what you find is, so what they did, what the farmers did is they took what dirt they had and piled it on top of each other and had these little irrigation ditches. So these are man-made things, but some of them go back 2,000 years. So lazy beds. And then you can see, if you look back up here, the familiar gneiss up above. So this is another feature along that plateau. This is one of the classic walks in the ascent area. And this is 1 billion year old fossilized waves. So 1 billion years ago, when this wasn't rock, it was a beach, and there were waves on it, and somehow the rock over time, that pattern survived, and it's now embedded into the shoreline there. So it's, this is taken in 2013. When we were there, the tide was wrong, and we couldn't actually see this spot. But it's there. So this is another of the features. There's geology. There's also archaeology, and this is some of the things that Virginia and Donald's wife Wendy kind of put together some things to do that were more oriented towards the archaeology. Anyway, this is an Iron Age broke about around the time of 2,000 years ago. But this, I'll show you a little bit more about this. There's some more of these on Sky. But this was this was actually a home, but it was a fortress as well, because there were a lot of meandering bands. So this is the last thing in this on the Clatskill beach. But this is something called stalactite, and this dark rock, which was originally thought to be due to maybe lava, is actually now thought to be due to a meteorite strike. And the next picture shows a close-up of some of the ejecta from that what is now thought to be a meteorite strike. Okay, so now we're going to go to nice country. This is nice, N-I-C-E, G-N-I-S country. So it's nice country, and it's also nice country. So. So this is all nice, and notice the little sailboat there, and look at the beach here. This is all nice, but this beautiful beach, and here we are on one of these boulders, highly folded Lewisian gneiss. The orange color is due to the various minerals that are mixed in, and in this case, it looks like it's iron and manganese. And here's another picture just a slightly different form of the banding here, this highly stressed banding. That's a little manual. It was very interesting. In 2012, Virginia and I went into the visitor center, and we were saying, you know, I had talked to John Heberger here about, well, you know, would anybody be interested in a talk on the geology in Scotland? He says, yeah, I think so. So we started going into the visitor center to find a book. And that's the book we found, and there is a copies of it up here, and it describes the geology in this ascent area. But then the person there, who was the attendant, said, well, you know, there's the book, but here's the man. So that's how we met Donald Fisher. He just happened to be there in 2012, and that's why this trip happened, because if we hadn't met him there, it would have never happened, because we needed a guy. We needed a real geologist familiar with the area. So that, well, we went back there, and Donald said, well, this is where history was made in 2012, where we met. Anyway, so that was cool. All right, so this is my picture of a Skerry dike. It's a lot neater than the big sprawling one at Skerry, because you can actually see it. This is here's the gneiss and here's the dolerite, and it's sort of, you know, it's not all etched away like it was. So I kind of like this one. So much smaller, of course. But anyway, so this is just a nice view of the mountains. This is Knisp on the left, and this you'll see in a lot of publicity or journals or books about the Highlands, this mountain, Sebelin, this very iconic shape. And yeah, so then a few of us went out to the very point of this, the very northern point here, and this is the Store Head Lighthouse, and it's about a 4 mile walk. But you're looking at, this is all the sandstone here. And as you go further along the shore, you get to one of the real iconic structures in this area. And this is called the Old Man of Store, because we're going to show you another old man here shortly in Skye. But this is a column of Torridonian sandstone that somehow survived the erosion process and is still standing. And this is some of the bedding and of the 1 billion year old sandstone that you find in this area. Okay, so back to the map. So what we've just been up along this shoreline here, and we're now going to do one more thing in this area, go to the Bone Caves, and that's about what I'm going to show you. That's where we're staying, Willott Pool. Then we're going to go down along the shoreline, and then go across Loch Creek and on our way to Skye. So this is a trail to the Bone Caves, and this is a rainy day, but these are the caves, and they were formed, this is all limestone, and they were formed before the last ice age, 10,000 years ago. But they're called the Bone Caves because bones were found in here, and many animals. And there's actually a walrus bone, 2,000 years old, that shows that was made into a pin. It shows that people actually lived here at that time. And here's a picture of all of us. Aaron, with Marcia, Pierre, and Mary, and Bonnie, and Donald, Christine, and Nancy over here. And this was, I never seen an artesian spring before, but there was one there, and it's just water bubbling up upward, and from where there wasn't anything, and all of a sudden there's a pond, and there's a stream that below it. So here's the promise of, there are trees, you'll see, and in certain protected places, and even some very pretty gardens. And I haven't actually been here myself, in spite of trying a couple of times. They were never open when we wanted to see them. But, you know, so there are flowers in Scotland. Yeah, and we were there a little early, but you'll find flowers everywhere. The 2013 trip, we were there in June, and in spite of the people saying that there the mosquitoes or the, but we really didn't see that many. So here's Jack and Susan Hales. Jack is a retired weatherman, and he was the weatherman on our trip. He kept us informed about the good, the bad, and the ugly as far as the weather goes. Yeah. Okay, so this is the last thing I'm going to show you, and that's in the Highlands. But this is Mount Shylock in Loch Maree, and this boundary here, all of this stuff down here, is the gneiss. And this is sandstone on top. So this is a big unconformity, 2.5 billion years of, no, 2 billion years of difference in 1 billion and 3 billion. But over here, the gneiss is underneath, and this is the sandstone, and this is quartz on top. So this is the quartz. And as John was saying earlier, this is right next to the area where I was just taking that picture, and it just shows you, it shows the description in the geopark, and it shows you what was going on, and made the point I made earlier that the sandstone was once 17,000 feet high. And it's now been etched down to 3,000 feet. Okay, so just quickly, this is the largest falls, and some people in the group did it. So there's the bottom. It's a hard picture to understand, but there's the bottom down there, and there's the stream at the top. And this is all through Moyne Schist. Some of the folks, I show it because some of the folks were there. This is a raised beach on our route. And the ocean was once at that level, and then it dropped, and it left that flat area, and, Ice Age raised beach. And on the way to Skye, we had lunch, and there's some of our folks. But there's our 33-passenger bus negotiating this interesting little turn here. And this was an amazing. The roads here are amazing. Now I'll tell you, some of us were bus drivers too, because Virginia and I drove up a 9-passenger van all the way from the London area up here, because that's how we were able to do different things to different parts of our group. And the drivers there, and the intrepid drivers, were myself, Jennifer, and John. And Virginia did a little bit, but I was too scared to let her drive. So, because these roads are narrow, there are lots of one-way roads, and this is a wide van. This thing was like 6.5 feet wide. So what I did is I put lipstick on the windshield, and when you put that lipstick mark on the center line, you were the proper distance away from the center line, and you didn't then have to worry so much about where the left side of the car was. So, and John found that very helpful as well. But somehow we managed to get the van back to London with only a minor crack in one of the mirrors. So, okay, so this is Skye, and how am I doing in time? Okay, I think I'm all right. This is Skye. Now, this is, and I'll talk to you about all these places, but first a little bit about the geology of Skye. This is all very different, except for the very part, the very eastern edge. The rest of Skye is all volcanic, and as John said earlier, when the Atlantic Ocean started to form around 60 to 70 million years ago, there was a hot spot there, and it's probably the same hot spot that's underneath Iceland there. And so this hot spot produced 24 separate lava flows that made up what is Skye. And the lava flows came from down here. So these were actually where the volcanoes were, and the remnants of it are the two mountain ranges, the Culin Mountains. And it's really the only real range of mountains. There are mountains in England, the UK, but this actually is a mountain range, and it's only real range. And I'll show you a little bit more about that. But we stayed in Portree, and then we immediately went up to the Durnish or Trotnernish Peninsula and saw a different old man, Kilt Rock, the Koorang, and Flora McDonald's. I have a little piece of notepaper here to tell me, remind myself what she did, but she's a historical figure. Then another day, we went over to the Dunvegan Castle, nice point, went to a distillery, saw another brook, and then we ended the trip down here in this area. So this is approaching Portree by car, or bus in this case. And we were staying in one of the hotels up in this area. And that's Portree in the morning. I was having breakfast and I looked out the window and I said, oh my God, this is beautiful. You'll probably notice, because of our experience in the Highlands, we did not see a lot of sunny days. Probably the most sun we saw was the very first day. But then, when we were in Skye, we saw sun. And so I had to get out and get some pictures. Portree as well. And so our very first full day here, we went up to this Trotternish Peninsula. And this is all lava. This is all 60.5 million year old tertiary lava flows that form all of this. And these are this is the old man of Storr, S-T-O-R-R. And I'll show you pictures of that shortly. In fact, here's one. So this is, we hike up from the road, and we're looking down these big waterways, and these are the Culin Mountains in the distance. And so this is just slightly harder lava that somehow managed to survive, and it's the hillside here is this escarpment which had these 24 different lava flows. Here's a picture that was in the newsletter, so it was really fun from a photographer standpoint. It would be raining one time and then it would clear and then the clouds, and it was just a delight to be here and to get this interesting mix of cloud and sun and the Culins right through the hole. And this is further north, this is all, again, it's all lava, but you have some isolated pieces. What happened is this whole chunk was once up here, and so this whole land slipped, and that's what you're looking at, are the various slips from the upper part. This is called the Koorang. Okay, this is a place that we all went to, and this is called Kilt Rock. It's all up in the same general area, and so some interesting things. If you look over here, you'll see these, this is all basalt columns. And what happens is when the basalt cools, it shrinks, and when it shrinks, it leaves these gaps. And because of physics and what have you, the preferred geometry for one of these cones is actually hexagonal, and that's the lowest energy shape for these things. Down here, we have a different thing going on. This is older sandstone. It's a Jurassic sandstone, 150 million years. And in between it are layers of dolerite lava. And that's the kilt, part of the kilt of the kilt rock in the sky. So here's Dick, Schwinn, and Lillian at Kilt Rock. And this is Flora McDonald's house. Who knows where Flora McDonald is? All right. Flora McDonald helped Bonnie Prince Charlie escape from Scotland after the last battle of Culloden, where he lost the Battle of Culloden in 1746. So she's a very romantic figure in Scottish history. And this is where her house was. This is now actually on the west coast of the Trotternish Peninsula. And so, okay, so we're back to the map, and so we were just up there, going back to portrait. The next day, we're going over to this area in Dunvegan Castle. And I think, oh no, yeah, first, the distillery. And we were treated, Donald managed to get a tour for us, and we had our own samples of some whiskey. And before the castle, we stopped at this Dunveg Brook, which is a double-walled structure. But just, you know, the sky here, the sky and sky was amazing. And now this is just for the photographers here, this is a panorama. So there's six pictures that went into making this picture. There's two pictures, HDR on one side, HDR on the other side, and then bringing them together in panorama. So there's our fearless leader. He is quite a character. This is what the brook actually looked like when it was fully assembled. So you had these this passageway, which was used for defensive purposes. It was a home as well as defense structure. And these are some of our folks walking down some of the steps in between the two walls. So this is Dunvegan, a little from a side trip that some of us made up to another brook, which I won't show you. But anyway, there's the castle sitting in the distance, and this is the castle closer up. And this is the oldest castle that is in Scotland that is still maintained by the originals, the Clan MacLeod. And we met, they are still living here. They close off part of it, and then the rest of it is open to visitors. And Queen Elizabeth, during World War II, spent a great deal of time up here, just to be away from London and the bombing. Okay, so this is a nice point. This is the very westerly point in Scotland. Geology is pretty much the same, tertiary basaltic lavas, but there's some intrusion. But so in the iconic lighthouse at the point. And this again is another six picture, panorama involving three pictures with high dynamic range. And this is an unusual one. This is the one that was in the newspaper. This is a vertical panorama. So it's two pictures on top of each other, one above and one below, then stitched together. But quite a dramatic point. And we had never been here before, so this was really wonderful experience. And here's some more of our travelers, Elizabeth and myself and Virginia at Nice Point. Okay, so we're getting close to the end of this, and the last part of the trip is down here in among the Culins. And some of us took a boat trip up Loch Corrisk, and some of us did something called the Camasunary Walk. And this is Mount Blauvin. This is Black Culin. This is one of the Black Culins. The Black Culins are made of basalt. The Red Culins are granite, which is much softer. I used to think granite was hard stuff, but it's not as hard as basalt. So what these mountains actually are, these are actually the magma chambers. This is the magma chamber. This is all the lava But all that lava, surface lava, has been eroded away, and what's left is the magma chambers. And so the black kulins are the intrusive version of our gabbro, the intrusive version of basalt, and they form jagged rocket mountains. The red kulins are from granite, the intrusive version of rhyolites. Interesting how these two different forms of, most of it's basalt, but there was some rhyolite as well, and they form the red kulins. And I think this next picture was taken by Donald. He sent this to me. And I show it mainly because you see the difference in the mountains. This is the black kulin over here, jagged rocket. This is the red kulin all rounded over, you know, soft, soft granite. And yeah, so this is the Kamisunari walk that we did. We were walking from the road, and about, maybe 6 miles round trip down to this beach. The Lac Corisc boat is behind this point. And here are some of the intrepid walkers as well. Jennifer, Budge, and Betty, and us. I think the next picture, oh yeah. This is a picture I took in 2012. Virginia and I actually climbed one of these black kulins, and you can see how rocky and jagged they are. This is Lac Corisc, though. It's right above it, and that is the lock. And the beach that we walked to is just visible. Anyway, it's back in this area where the Kamisunari walk was, over this bump and then down to it here. These are some of the biggest mountains. These are 3,000 foot mountains that we've dealt in Great Britain. But you're climbing it all the way from sea level, so it's still a fair climb. Okay, so we're ending the talk with a few some wildlife. This is a couple of seals, and we have a Highlands cow. Yeah, so this is kind of fun. And here is the last group picture, and this is a bit of a swindle, but it is everybody here, but they weren't all here when to get this picture taken, so I took people from other pictures and I put them in, including Donald. He wasn't in this picture. He was taking this picture. Yeah, you look a little, yeah, he looks like he's elevated a little bit. You would have never seen and caught that if I hadn't told you. But that's it. Oh, sorry. Ooh. All right, what did I do? I guess. Yeah. Okay, I'll end it there. There was one last picture that John had here, and I'm not going to go all the way through the whole talk again to get to it. So we'll just. Yeah, I guess. I have to be at the computer. And John is at the computer, so John's scrolling it down. Yeah. So this trip, this talk, is actually the for us, Virginia and I's kind of something that began in 2012 when we met. With Donald, and then we found him again after the 2000. There it is. There's the last picture.
We'd be happy to answer questions, but before we do that, if everyone that was on the trip just stand up. Part of why I encourage you to be members, because that's quite a trip, quite an event, and John says we have just a few minutes.
Well, I'll just make one last point. I want to acknowledge what John did here. We sort of got the trip started, but John, we wouldn't have had this trip. He did all of the logistic planning and the travel arrangements and an incredible amount of work to pull this off. So it really was a partnership that we...
Thoughts, questions, comments? Yeah.
Yeah, one of those pictures, you have the ocean in the background and a bunch of lakes in the foreground. Are they saltwater lakes or freshwater?
I'm thinking they're freshwater.
Freshwater? Yeah, there's plenty of water around here.
But that Loch Carisk, the one I just showed you there, looks like it's fresh water, but it actually is connected to the sea because they took a boat trip into it.
Okay.
Yeah. That one's fresh water. Yeah. I mean, salt water.
How long were you in Scotland?
We were there 2 weeks, 14 days.
Two weeks.
And a few of us spent a few extra days, went down to Edinburgh, went all but good. No, not every day. I think we had about 3 or 4 nice sunny days, but as long as you have the right equipment, you're okay. Yes, ma'am. What exercise program were we on, Doc, to prepare for this?
Don't get your knees done a few months before.
Yeah. It looks very spectacular from the photographs, but in fact, the hikes, the trails are quite good, just like up here in the Grand Tetons. Where there's not trails, you're just kind of working your way across this boggy, peaty, which is, you know, it's kind of interesting. Your boots, every night you came home and you put your boots on the heater to dry out. But other than that, it was not hard at all. He just, the best advice I got on this whole trip was from Mike, and he said, do not go on this trip without walking sticks. I've never had walking sticks before. I got them for Ann and I, and we used them. They were helpful. Other thoughts? Yes?
Forgive my ignorance, John. What's the difference between dolerite dikes and diorite dikes?
Oh, boy.
I think it's a name, a similar name for the same thing, diorite and dolerite. I was looking it up today.
Thank you.
And it's pretty much the same rock. It's just it's all basalt.
Yeah.
And it's all dark.
Very hard black rock, basically.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we want to thank you. One more. Okay.
Quick question.
Yes, sir.
In England, is the hot outlet on the right?
Of course.
And do you have to leave a coin every time you take a photograph?
Well, you have to have something for reference, otherwise you wouldn't know the size of the tubes, you know? And no, I'm not going to tell you whose toe that is.
One last little announcement. If any of you are interested in seeing more of these pictures, and also on a slightly larger scale, so we're going to give a talk at the Armchair Adventures in next week, Thursday the 14th, so 6:30 p.m. in the Rec Center. So it'll be some of the same pictures, but it covers more ground in Scotland.
And I would encourage you to come up and look
at the rocks. Here.
That's the book table. This is the rock table. They're all kind of laid out. You can actually pick them up. And do leave them here, please. But you can actually feel some of these rocks and look at the different nature, including this is probably one of the more interesting ones where this is where this meteorite, I didn't believe it until I actually got down and looked at the rock. And it's just kind of the Torridonian sandstone, and you see these little green blobs in it that are the ejecta that came out. And the way they know that is when you look at that with a thin section, you can see the quartz in there is soda form. It actually has its own name. It's called shock quartz. What is it? Schwebite. And so I didn't believe it. In rock, the thin sections, it really is that. So enjoy, look around at the rest of the material, the maps up on the walls. Thank you very much. And
in 2 weeks' time, Sarah Gatzi of Idaho State University will be here to talk about the